If you look at everything, it's only one concept that everybody is trying to explain in millions and millions of different ways. Like, think about love. So think about how many movies are made on love, how many stories are written on love, just to explain that concept of love, and how many lives have experimented love, billions and billions, right? So one truth, but there are many different ways of telling it, because we love varieties. Just like we don't get satisfied with one kind of food all the time, so we need varieties. But when we become a little bit more aware of the truth itself without getting swayed away by the varieties of it, then we'll be in trouble. So for that, today I'm going to talk about the true knowledge. What is the importance of the true knowledge in our life? Without the true knowledge, we won't be successful, isn't it? Knowledge is power. Lack of knowledge is lack of power, right? So I'll start with a small story. So the story goes like, in the village, there was an old lady and she was very fond of everybody. So wherever she had a problem, the whole village would come and help her out. So one day so happened that she was frantically looking out on her veranda for something. She was searching here and there all the time. She was having a broomstick and then cleaning up several times. So all the villagers were just watching it, watching her looking something frantically. So all those people came and then asked her, "Auntie, what are you looking for? Is there any way that we can help?" So this person, this old lady said like, "Now, look, I'm looking for that needle. It's so important for me. I have to sew that cloth for myself. And can you please help me to look for that lost needle? You know, because needle is so small, so obviously it takes a lot of time for an old lady to find it." So everybody started looking out in the veranda, everywhere, all around. Hours went by and they couldn't find the needle. And somebody asked her, "Where exactly did you lose the needle? Can you tell us exact point so that we can micro search there and then probably we can find it?" And to everybody's surprise, the old lady said, "You know, last night I was stitching my torn out cloth in my bedroom, way in the house. And then the needle got lost." Then everybody said, like, "If you were sewing your cloth in the bedroom, way inside the hall, inside the house, why are you looking outside?" Then the lady said, "Look, there is no light inside the room, right? There is way out light here. That's why I'm searching for the needle." Right? So this is a very powerful and profound story. You might laugh it away, but look at, we already know what is the truth, but don't we search for the truth all around? It's like that Kasturi Mrig, right? That special deer in India, that have got an arrow mask on her forehead. And all his life, the deer looks around, moves around frantically here and there to search for that fragrance. Where is it coming from? Where is it coming from? Of course, he won't know that the fragrance is coming from her forehead. It's hidden. True knowledge is there, but we are not aware of it, where to search for. And even though you're aware of it, because of certain things that happens in our life, which is I'm going to talk about today, because of that factor, we always try to look for the lost needle way out in the light, even though we lost it inside the house. I'll give you a simple concept of Vedanta today. You know, Vedanta is the treasure house of all the yogic knowledge, Vedantic knowledge. So yoga and Vedanta are sister science. If you look at Vedanta as the science of life, yoga is the technology of life, so it implements on that. So if you look at the whole concept, there is a philosophy called Sankhya philosophy in the Vedantic wisdom. There are different systems. So without going there, I'll just talk about, so this system talks about, there is always a pair of two things. A pair of two things, like there is a male component, there is a female component, right? That's how we get the electricity. There is a positive current, there is a negative current. There is a sun element, there is a moon element, right? There is a male and female I talked about, positive and negative I talked about. There are Purusha and Prakriti. There is Shiva and Shakti. Even in the computer world, we talk about 0 and 1. It's a binary form, right? Without that, we can't even compute anything. So likewise, there is a concept called Brahman and Maya. So the Maya is a part of the Prakriti. And Purusha or the Brahman is a part of the universe, which is the truth. The Maya or the Prakriti always goes on changing. Everything that you can think about changing all the time, belonging to the realm of Maya or the illusion of the mind. The mind has created the Maya, but the universe, the nature, the God has created the Brahman. So this Maya and Brahman always go together. For example, if you look at your own being itself, we have a body, we have a mind. So if you ask yourself, what is real? What is not changing? Is the body real? Is the mind real? Because something that is real should not undergo any changes. It should be constant, right? It should be all the time the same thing. That's real thing. Real thing don't go for changes. But something which is flaky, something which is not real, which constantly goes on changing. And if you look at your own body, it's constantly changing, isn't it? From the day that you're born, you're a tiny little baby. If I take a picture of that, and then 1 year old yourself, 2 year old yourself, 5 year old, 10 years old, 20 years old. So if I take about 500 pictures of yours in a timeline and project it somewhere or put it on a wall, I think it will be very difficult for you to recognize yourself. And particularly when I mix up all your childhood pictures with millions of other pictures, you'll be having difficulties to find it, right? So that means our body is constantly changing. One day it was 1 year old, then you say that I'm 2 year old. One day you said like I'm a toddler, I'm a teenager, now I'm employed, now I'm married, I'm divorced, I'm employed, I don't have a job, I'm healthy, I'm sick, I'm wealthy, I don't have money. So all these things, in all these 10 sentences that I made, if you ask, what is that common thing which is not changing? So the common denominator of all the sentences that I made is I. That I is the bigger I, not the egoistic I that identifies itself with different objects, including the body and mind. So that bigger I is the self which is not changing at all. So this is a change in changing and unchanging stuff. They're also together. Without having an unchanging surface, you cannot notice the change. I'll give you a simple example. In front of me, there is a big clock on the wall, and I can see that clock. There are number handles, there are minute handles, there are hour handles. There are different numbers written. But behind all these number handles and all these things, there is a white dial. That dial is steady. Only the hour handles, the minute handles are moving. So if the dial also were moving, then probably I won't be able to notice the time. Because if both are changing, both are moving, then I won't have a reference of that. If the number dial is moving and also the hour handles are moving, I won't know what is the time. So in order to get a proper time or the actual utility of the clock, one has to be steady, the other has to move. So the movement of the needles are more concrete with respect to that unchanging dial. Likewise, behind everything that is changing in this life, there must be something unchanging, which is registering all these changes, which is witnessing all these changes. And that unchanging self is the Brahman. That unchanging self is the Atman. That unchanging self is the Purusha. That unchanging self is that I. So that I doesn't change. The body as a part of Prakriti always changes. The mind also belongs to the Prakriti, made up of five elements: the earth, water, fire, air and space, the Pancha Mahabhut and the different Tanmatras. So these subtle objects, the subtle elements, they constitute our body because it is made up of these material objects, the elemental objects, Pancha Mahabhut. The body is constantly changing. So when we understand this very concept that myself or the self is different from the body, the self is different from the mind. It's a great, profound knowledge that the Indian yoga system gives to the world. So once you learn this concept, then you'll be able to deal with your body in a different way. You'll be able to deal with your mind in a different way. Just like if you have a car and you identify that you are not your car, you have a house, you identify that you are not your house, you have a spouse, you identify that you are not your spouse, you have children, you identify that you are not your children, they are separate from you. So the moment you identify yourself separate from your spouse, from your children, from your house, from your car, if something goes wrong with those objects, those subjects, those people, or those things in your life or beings in your life, you can do something about it, isn't it? If the car is broken, I can go to the insurance company and claim for it, or I can get it fixed. If my house is broken, I can get a handyman and get it fixed. If something happens to my children, I can go to the doctor and then talk about that, or if something happens, I can do something about it, isn't it? Because I'm separate from that. So likewise, if you think about it a little bit more deeper, your body is separate than you. Your mind is separate than you. You are the Brahman and the body is the Maya. So if you go a little bit more deeper, then we just talk about what are the different attributes of the Brahman and Maya. So the Maya has got two attributes, namely, one is a name and one is a form. So anything and everything that you see in the entire universe, which has a name and a form, that you can relate to something that looks somehow, or there is a name to it, like universe, like earth, like a tree, like a house, like a human being, like a coronavirus. So everything that has a name and a form is not permanent. It's transitory in nature. It will go away. It will perish in due course of time, including our own body. Our body doesn't remain forever. After 80, 90 years, after 100 years, this body will die. But the self will never die. Think about it. So the Maya has got these two things, names and forms. Anything which is a form and a name, you can categorically put them into one basket that's called Maya, which is temporary, who doesn't have the reality, who is not real, which is always constantly changing. And those are Maya things, elusive things. They are all the delusions of the brain or the mind. I talk about that later. How the brain hallucinates everything to make a meaning of everything that we see outside through our eyes. Coming back to the Brahman, which is the unchanging self, that has got three attributes. In Sanskrit, they call it sthiti, bhati, and priti. In other words, sat, chit, and ananda. In English, pure existence, pure consciousness, and pure bliss. Sat, chit, and ananda. That means everything exists. From the existence point of view, there is no differentiation. The mountain has the same existence than a small molecule, a virus. The ant has the same existence as an elephant. The king has the same existence from a pauper. So existentially, everything is same. Everything exists. That's the property. Now, the second aspect is bhati. Bhati means that awareness. Bhati means that light which illuminates that, which tells to the world that I'm existing. That is the chit aspect of it, the consciousness aspect of it. I am existing. I've got some power to express myself. I've got some power to illuminate myself. So everything that is created by the Brahman has got some existence, which is existence, also has the power to talk about itself, express about, just like a flower has a beautiful nature, the color, the fragrance. Those are all different attributes that expresses itself, its truth, its nature. Existence, pure consciousness, and the bliss. Everything has got a positive, a blissful thing that gives you happiness, that's priti, right? That ananda, that bliss, that factor of happiness. So anything and everything, if you look at, has got something relevant to give some pleasure to the world. That's why it said, not a single grain, not a single leaf, not a single object that is created in the entire universe is useless at all. Everything has got its own properties. Everything has got its own existence. Everything has their own illuminating power. They're beautiful. They're powerful. That they come to the Brahman. They come from the Brahman. So Brahman has got three characteristics, three attributes. The Maya has got two. Once you differentiate between these two, what is real and what is unreal, what is Maya and what is Brahman, what is Purusha, what is Prakriti, then you'll have no confusion in life. In fact, if you look at a swan, Hansa, has got this unique ability to differentiate the milk from the water. So if you give a pot of milk and water mixed together, the swan will drink the milk and leave the water aside. Isn't it a very unique quality? So that's why the Hamsa is considered as a title to given to self-realized souls, enlightened masters. They get this title of Paramahamsa, like Paramahamsa Ramakrishna, Paramahamsa Yogananda Saraswati, Paramahamsa Krishnavatar. So all these titles are given to the self-enlightened people because they have got the power to discriminate what is Maya and what is Brahman. And then they choose Brahman. Remember I talked about Shreyas and Prayas in one of the talks? What is good and what is pleasant. Always life will be offering us this opportunity to discern or to discriminate or to understand what is good for us, what is real and what is unreal. And then if you choose by disciplining your mind the right thing, the Brahman, then automatically your life will be always moving in the right direction. It's like a climometer, like a compass. Always Brahman Maya, Brahman Maya, Brahman Maya. So if you look at the Brahman aspect, what is real? Like look at anybody that you look at, most of the time the hatred comes because of the name and form. Maybe that person doesn't look good, maybe that person doesn't have all the attributes that you are expecting. That's where the anger comes into your life. But if you look at the Brahman aspect of it, the real existence, consciousness and the bliss is all there. You just have to change your perspective of life. You have to step back and look at that unchanging self, which is all there all the time, which is not changing. But if you look at the changing aspect of another person, then you will always subject of the Maya or the illusion of the mind. And that has got stress, worries, anxieties, fear, everything. And that primarily happens at a body level consciousness. We have Annamaya Kosha, the physical body. So if you constantly remain and refer to the body level consciousness, you'll be more subject and more susceptible to the power of Maya. But if you slowly, taking 2 minutes, 3 minutes of meditation, and then take a holy dip into the Brahman, which is the pure existence, the source of infinite intelligence, which is all within you, then automatically you'll be coming out from the clutches of the Maya or the illusion, and slowly, slowly move towards the Brahman, what is the real truth, which is the pure happiness, pure joy. And those happiness are million times powerful than the happiness that we derive from the objective world. Million times, even sometimes say billion times. It's very subtle, very deep in quality. So once you have even a fraction of a moment, you get an experience of that state of mind, which is explained in the concept of samadhi, in the deep meditation, you will understand how powerful and how beautiful those experiences are. So friends, we are talking about Maya and Brahman, which is a part of the pure Vedantic knowledge, which is the true knowledge. So once we acquire this true knowledge, we'll have the right attitude, with the right mindset, with the right knowledge, with the right skills, right tools, right techniques, then we'll be unstoppable. We'll be always successful. Because success doesn't matter what you derive at. The journey should be the reward. So if you are still striving for your excellence, you are never a failure. So success is defined by you,